going to define it in that context. Before, seeing as we have a little more time, before we get started on that, I'd like people to think about what it is that they about, first of all, nature that has brought you here today, that has brought you to what you're doing in life. And to try and to picture that in your mind, what is it about nature that has made it your calling, I guess? I don't know if you need to close your eyes to think about that. I'd really like you to be able to describe it to me afterwards. So what is it about nature that has made you do what it is you're doing today? If you can picture nature, in what nature means to you in your mind, think about it for a few seconds. And then, without really breaking your thought, to think about what agriculture means to you, what food production, what does that look like? Is it linked? Is it very separate? When you think of it as an image. Would anyone like to share what their visions look like?
Sure. For me, nature is like wilderness, sort of wildness, and agriculture is kind of the antithesis of that. In my mind, conventional agriculture.
For me, it's almost the opposite. I think we are naturally part of nature, and when you walk in a forest, say in Indonesia or so, there's food everywhere. Yep. So for me, the forest and nature and agriculture is all one thing, but we've sort of created the synthetic separation between the two. Which makes no sense at all.
Pretty much the top of your talk, so that's perfect. Yes.
Probably could be a hunter-gatherer, so it was very nice to be able to work with nature to feed ourselves. And it was 7 billion people, and only 50% of them are urban and never in nature. And we have been forced to develop an agriculture which is completely separate. Because we decided to multiply many times.
It's from my view, this is talking from an urban aesthetic, but
this is the way we always do it. Okay. So, good evening, everybody. Welcome to this month's talk. My name is Vincent. I'm the project manager for WESM. And just briefly, I think there is our speaker this month. He works in agroforestry in Malawi, mainly in villages, trying to see how they can grow food using agroforestry measures, etc. And I think that's what he's going to talk about this evening. And so, Pierre, it's up to you. You can continue.
Does this work now?
Yeah, it is.
Great. So we have three very different answers and exactly kind of what I was looking for, so thank you very much. Very important, and I guess I'll learn this all. First of all, this is going to be a structured breakdown of the talk. That's it. So I'll go through conventional agriculture, this kind of war on nature that Christa described. Then agroforestry in its many different forms, including from different parts of the world, different climates, and including my own experience. And there's a conclusion as a statement, and then opening it up for questions. And if you have any burning questions during the talk, please do put your hand up, but otherwise I will just leave questions to you. So my definition of agroforestry is a little bit different to the one you would find if you Google it, which will give you something like integrating and conserving trees. My definition is much more inclusive, so agroforestry, agriculture plus forests, integrating forest systems into agriculture. There is quite a key difference between trees and forest systems. Trees are a component part of the forest, they are not forests in themselves. So that
informs our thoughts.
And also, as I said briefly at the beginning, that definition comes about through my experience with agriculture, which is a much, much broader sector. So yeah, civilization based on conventional agriculture makes nature the enemy, destroys ecosystems, it's based on scarcity and fear. We're always talking about food crises. It's hard work and it requires and fosters social hierarchies. That's more, but that's enough to get us started. This is conventional agriculture. The reason I put it in inverted commas is that there's nothing really very conventional about this. It's actually a masterstroke of agribusiness to pull this conventional, because it puts everything else in opposition. So we then have to define ourselves as unconventional, which I'm actually fine with personally, but does create some kind of, it's not a fair starting point. And this really is how you create a desert. You almost see it happening, the desert in the background being created. Everything that is being grown here is dependent on massive inputs of chemicals, fungicides, pesticides, herbicides, which is killing the soil. We're killing the soil, and we depend on the soil for life. Killing the soil means creating a desert. Also, you're creating food that is really, this is where all our junk food and type of things are coming from. But also, the cities, as the gentleman was saying, we are dependent on huge amounts of food being produced, where the cities are not producing very much food. So there does have to be something that's producing large amounts of food for the city. But this isn't what it should look like. Right? So sadly, this is what a lot of our African maize look like. And it's really hard to create a desert by hand. This is very similar to the last photograph, except that we don't have machinery, everything's done by hand, much harder work. And the results are the same. If you look closely at the soil, you can see where the water is running off, it's erosion. And this is sort of, as someone said, the antithesis of nature. So yeah, unfortunately the result of the first photograph and these two photographs is that we're well on our way to desertification. And if you leave the soil like this, the burning African sun all year round, don't cover it, burn all organic matter as well, that's how you create a desert. And it kind of already looks like one. And there are some trees here. This is a landscape we're very used to. Mango trees, mandarins, but most of the indigenous forest is just decimated and gone. Factory farming is not limited to fields. These are animals. This is the type of image that turns a lot of people into vegetarians. These are heavy input systems and extremely unhealthy and unhappy. Now, the reason I use all those words is heavy input systems in the sense you can't keep pigs like this without plying them with medication for one thing. You have to bring food to them. They're not doing anything. They're not finding in the farm. Extremely unhealthy for the pigs, obviously, but also for ourselves. If we're eating, we are what we eat, we are also what we eat eats, right? What we eat eats. We can go do that forever. And unhappy, yeah, for the animals in question, but also for ourselves. Like this, as I said, drives a lot of people to vegetarianism, and there's a good reason for that. This is a really horrific sight. Nature has no place in the modern world. It certainly seems that way. Obviously that's not what I think. But yeah, it looks like that. You can see sort of the depiction of mass extinction of all the animals being driven, I declare. And that is what we're going towards. And again, we have to put this in the context of growing populations. We do need to find ways to feed growing populations all over the world. But this is the way to do it, not against nature. A war on nature, yeah, is completely ridiculous and is a war against ourselves. Now, I don't think we've reminded that person we went to war against ourselves, Sarah Palin. But in general, we don't really want to encourage shooting ourselves in the head. So, civilization based on permaculture, of which agroforestry is a component, you know, we're allowed to find it, makes nature our ally, basically all the opposite of what we saw before. Makes nature our ally, restores and protects the ecosystem based on abundance and compassion, aims to reduce work, aims to liberate us from social hierarchy. Again, there's loads more we could say, but I'm going to leave it at that for now. We'll go into all those points. Social hierarchy is one that I wanted to point out. I won't get into this in too much detail, obviously. I'm sure everyone's aware of this, but there are some obvious benefits to industrial agriculture and certain small numbers of people making a huge amount of money. So that could very well be a Malawian farmer at the bottom of that pyramid of cash saying, you're confining us to poverty. It's the same thing. And what permaculture does, by releasing us from these social hierarchies, is giving us the option of independence and freedom for the best one at the bottom, and putting us in a position where we can advocate for reform. Nature is a bit chaotic. So this is one of the other reasons why we are going to war with nature. I think there's a question in the last slide. It's very difficult to feed modern societies based on this. Incredibly abundant, as Chris said. You can walk through here, you can find medicinal plants, foods, mushrooms, everything. But that would be more based on a hunter-gathering society, foraging society. And we've really moved away from that, unfortunately. But there are obviously some still surviving. But in general, we have to feed big urban populations that are going to have to be even more soon. What I'd like to point out, though, is what nature's doing here. So you have production everywhere in this system, from the floor to the climax of trees, and up the trees with climbers. So we really need to think about that, to inform the way that we practice agriculture, because this remains an abundant system. Might not suit us exactly, but it's very abundant. Instead, we do this to it, and come back to this image. If I imagine it sort of looks like some kind of alien invasion to me. But surely we can do better than that.
And it's really striking how it becomes two dimensional from three dimensional.
Yes. So that's really in this. There's no stacking. Like, okay, so this is a word we use in permaculture. But previously, here, as I said, you have production on every layer. You have production on one layer, and it's dependent on external inputs. Agroforestry, making nature more user-friendly. So this is in France, as I told you, with images from everywhere. Even the combine harvest is the same. So it works. They're producing wheat here with poplar trees. So this is the most sort of simplified version of agroforestry that suits an industrial context. This can still be existing, but there's a lot more going on here. You're producing wood, you're storing carbon, you're contributing to the water cycle by having the trees in the fields. This might not be the ideal for a permaculturist, but this is a very good halfway point between fully destructive industrial agriculture and a system that fully mimics nature. Okay? So the reason I put the bottom tobacco farmers in the context of Malawi tobacco farms are often going into our indigenous forests and destroying the forests to get wood to kill tobacco. Now, if you created systems that produced wood on site, then you can really mitigate that problem. Welcome. Incidentally, tobacco farms are sort of supposed to do this with eucalyptus trees, but they tended to move away from that for whatever reason. I think there is a tendency with people who work in permaculture, agroecology, agroforestry, to rather than engage in dialogue with big agribusinesses or tobacco farmers, to sort of alienate them and to say, well, you know, that's the antithesis of what we want to do, that we're not going to talk to them. But that doesn't help. It's a natural reaction, of course, but it doesn't help. We can actually say to them, listen, if you do it this way, use these species, you're going to save money and make more money, and yeah, you're not going to destroy the environment at the same time, so that would be great too. Okay? So, we should, there's another permaculture principle, integrate, then segregate. Never segregate yourself from anything. Okay? If you can engage in dialogue, do so. So, coming back to a little bit to one of the images, the earlier image, which was more of nature, which was more of a jungle context, it was very tropical. This is more of a typical Malawian woodland, backstage of trees. They're still growing, lots going on every level, ground level, shrubs, all the way up. And it's still a bit chaotic. This is still not going to suit production for a Malawian population. But it is inherently resilient. It's one of the things that I want to bring up as well today is that nature can deal with climate shocks a lot better than our conventional agriculture can. Right? If this is hit by drought, these plants go deep, their roots go deep, the soils are much healthier. There are lots of nitrogen-fixing plants in there where there are plants that will be breaking down minerals and making them available to other plants. It's a system that feeds off itself. It's a closed cycle. Okay. So if you hit that sort of iron maize field with a drought, that's it. Okay. It has no resilience at all. Again, I'm recycling images, but nature is not present and the system is fragile. Okay. This is exactly what I've just been describing. This is. In our agriculture context. So what do? We mimic forest systems. That doesn't mean that we plant forests and we expect to feed animal populations or growing populations on them. It means that we literally mimic the system, the inherently resilient system of the forest. So this is a picture from Kusumala, just outside Lilongwe. I encourage everyone to go there and take a look at what they're doing. So I'm just going to describe a little bit what's going on. You saw in the previous photograph, I'll just show you briefly again, ridges, okay? That's a typical way of planting maize that we have in Malawi. Ridges, plant maize into them, maybe plant some beans and pumpkin, that's it, okay? Here we make permanent beds to start off with, which are obviously we will use compost, organic manure, isn't it? Everything is on contour. You can see none of the beds are straight. There are no straight lines in nature. Everything being on contour means that water can be trapped in between the beds, so you can see the moisture in between the beds. That means the moisture then sinks into the land and is meant to work. You want water to work for you, not just disappear or evaporate as fast as possible. Okay? So, then you're planting diversity. So, you saw in the pictures of forests and of both forests that there's something going on every layer. Here we've got beans on the edge of the beds. There's also cassava leaves here, cassava in the beds. Beans fix nitrogen, cassava raises a hormone that encourages tree root growth. It's also drought resilient. The organic matter in the bed protects the soil from evaporation. It's also encouraging soil life. Okay, so you have lots and lots of stuff going on, even at that lowest level. Then the next level, all of this is prosia. The background, the pigeon pea into prosia. Pigeon pea fixes nitrogen. It also provides a great food for everyone to enjoy. And to prosia also produces nitrogen. You can cut it back just before the rains, which also helps to build soil. When you cut back to prosia and pigeon pea, what it does is it also prunes the roots. Okay? So those trees, those shrubs that will have accumulated atmospheric nitrogen and put it into the soil, and you cut it back, they'll release that nitrogen and make it available to your maize, which is what's going to be planted into these fields. But not just maize. Okay? And when we talk about food security, we also have to talk about nutrition security, which is called by diversity. If you have a lot of diversity, then you have healthier people and you have healthier systems and more resilient systems. So what we're doing is intentionally designing resilience into our maize fields like this. You can see in the background there's a tree, that will be our climax layer. We're very, very lucky in Africa to have loads of nitrogen fixing trees, so trees that will break into the hub and will fix nitrogen and that won't actually create too much shade, so they're perfect agroforestry trees. I'll go into that a little bit more later because we can't see that anything. This is one of the other things that's happening when we have a system that is protected, like in the last one, a more resilient system that mimics nature. Mycelium can grow. So mycelium are fungi, basically. So if you have a lot of decaying matter on the beds, that's going to encourage fungi, right? What fungi does, apart from giving us mushrooms, is creates a network of sort of extensions to the roots. And this says it can help the nutrient acquisition up to 700 times. This really explains it very well. The fungi links up with the plant's roots. There's an exchange going on, a symbiotic relationship. The plants feed the fungi with sugars, and the fungi feed the plants with minerals from deeper down on the slope. Now, if you leave a field completely bare in the dry season, there's nothing there, obviously the fungi then die back as well, because there is no relationship going on anymore. If you use drought-resistant plants like tuberosia, like pigeon pea, like a lot of trees that we have available to us, that relationship can keep going on through the dry season. Cassava as well is really good for that drought-resistant crop and a great emergency food. So there are lots of reasons for keeping perennials in your fields. So this is one of the trees, probably my favorite tree in Malawi, Sandal is the local name, Wimpthorn is the English name. Nature is abundant, it offers us loads and loads of choices. Fedogravida is not the only one that we can use. Whitethorn is another very popular one. There are so many different types of acacia that we could use. They're fixing nitrogen. The beautiful thing about this one is it provides shade at a time of year that other trees do not. Okay? But what that does is it encourages birds to settle in it, encourages animals to come and settle underneath it, and those animals will fertilize the land. And when the tree loses its leaves, the leaves are very, very small, and they'll break down very quickly and become available to the plants, to our leaves, the leaf, or ideally to our highly diverse systems mimicking nature underneath. Now, what we don't have underneath these trees is dispersion, pigeon pea, and all the rest of it. So, a complete system really would be this image superimposed on the one before. So, I want to talk a little bit about animals, because we haven't covered that at all yet, apart from the horrible image of the pigs in the factory. And I like to think of animals as the ultimate expression of an ecosystem. You think of these as a grassland or a forest. To separate them from a forest is silly. They are a moving part of a forest or a grassland. So when we think about designing agroforestry, agricultural systems, animals need to be integrated. How can we do that? Well, we can't farm bees, so but we can farm chickens. Okay, chickens have performed the same function. They will cycle nutrients through the system. This is, I think, an apple orchard with lots of chickens running around. They perform the same function, as I said, as birds would in a natural system. This is Polyface Farm in the United States. And this man is called Joel Sargent. He's amazing. I recommend everyone reading what he's written.
Sorry, can you repeat his name?
Joel Sargent. What he does is farm more grasslands than forests, but it can be applied to an agroforestry system as well. These fences are not permanent, they get moved around his grasslands. His chickens move around, eating a lot of the pests, fertilizing the land. You will have cows go through first, the chickens will come afterwards, they'll scratch through the manure. It's also on a really good scale. He's proved that you can do this on scale. If you're talking about feeding growing populations, not a problem. We can do that, and we can do it in a way that increases fertility of the land, that builds soil. It's good for the animals, and it's good for us. You get happy chickens, but eating a happy chicken makes us happy too, okay? Unless you're a vegetarian.
Okay?
We don't want to be doing this. It's just, no one wants to see this, and it's completely stupid. It's like the big photograph for those of you who are here. Huge amounts of inputs are needed for this, for eating antibiotics, for eating all sorts of things. You get big, fat, fake, tasteless chickens. A lot of these chickens won't even be able to walk. They feed them so much so fast that they just collapse onto their legs and just, and there's no need for it, is the point. You could approach an industrial chicken farm and say, this is way more labor intensive, way less cost efficient.